Welcome to an earthly paradise. Or what's left of it. This is Angkor, a complex of elaborate temples in northwestern Cambodia, once home to 750,000 people. Ancient sacred sites built in the 12th century, abandoned and neglected for 700 years. But archaeologists are discovering an Angkor that is much more than just temples. Recently unearthed canals and reservoirs in a sophisticated network suggest that this was a vast metropolis.
What that tells us is that there's actually structure in here.
Now, scientists are looking for evidence of a civilization much larger than anyone ever dreamed. Water is important to many religions. It can be used to wash away evil and sin. But there's evidence that water was even more vital for the people of Angkor. Huge reservoirs and intricate canals unearthed in the jungle seem to have been used for everyday living, not just for ceremonies. If that's true, Angkor's population and size would have dwarfed the familiar sites of the central temples and their surroundings. Over 1,000 years ago, the Khmer people began to emerge from the dark and tangled forests of Southeast Asia. They were deeply influenced by Hindu and Buddhist texts and built temples to their faith. The 12th century temple of Angkor Wat, the temple of the capital. Just one of the many sanctuaries at Angkor. These are the largest sacred structures ever built, 10 times larger than any European cathedral. They're often said to be the work of the gods. Into the 11th century, the Khmer expanded their lands from the Chinese border in the north to the South China Sea, from Myanmar in the west to Vietnam in the east. But the grandeur of Angkor's temples hints at an even larger kingdom. New discoveries suggest this was the greatest city in the ancient world. These silent forests teem with evidence that suggests the real source of the kingdom's prosperity and expansion. Once before, experts linked Angkor's success to its many waterways, but the theory fell on deaf ears. Now, the investigation of a number of barais, vast water reservoirs around the temple sites, is bringing the old idea back. Professor Roland Fletcher of the University of Sydney, Australia, leads the team that is investigating this theory afresh. He explains how views have changed over the last 30 years.
The change that occurred in the 80s was that a group of English scholars began to argue that there were no outlets to the Great Barai and that there weren't any great canals, and that this was essentially water organized for a very elaborate and sophisticated ritual purpose, and for, as far as one could judge from their propositions, really no other purpose.
Experts agree that in Khmer and Hindu myth, the moats and reservoirs represent the featureless oceans, out of which the land and humans emerged. But what about the multitude of channels and dams? The world's largest temple, Angkor Wat, can still be seen from the Barai, and for all its beauty, it's easily outclassed by West Barai's sheer size.
Everybody talks about Angkor as being enormous, but even if you take the whole enclosure of Angkor Wat, it's only a fraction of the size of the West Barai, which is the vast piece of water that we're sitting in. Angkor Wat is actually a medium-sized construction of the Khmer Empire and the Khmer world. This is the real big stuff. This is the spectacular stuff.
It's the world's biggest water reservoir, and it dates from the Middle Ages. 8 kilometers long and nearly 2 kilometers wide. But it's only a part of the Angkor water management system. The West Barai is matched by another reservoir in an identical location east of the city. But this East Barai has dried up, allowing archaeologists to uncover some of its secrets. In the green fields of the reservoir floor, Fletcher has found the remains of a structure close to its eastern edge. Could this be an outlet valve for the water? That would mean quite a sophisticated understanding of hydraulic engineering. In no time, the local workers strip away the vegetation. It's a massive wall, over 2 meters high and nearly as thick. And then they find drill holes. Intricate workmanship on the dense laterite blocks. So this structure isn't ornamental. Canals are a serious and delicate business. You can't just fill them with water. The water must flow so it doesn't turn stagnant.
There's three of them. It's that big one. And then there's two smaller ones there. So there was a barrier here. Now that ran all the way across. They're in that wall as well over there, aren't they?
Yes, and I don't.
Okay. So what was here at some point in time was a big fence running all the way across with quite large beams running through it. And one of the things that they could have done with that in the Angkorian period is to put matting on the Barai side, and that acts as a blocker because vegetation comes up against the matting, and that acts as a barrier to water, and then you can cut that barrier and the water flows through.
The beams suggest a system for temporarily holding back the flow, something that only a vast metropolis would need. Where the beams held back the water, Fletcher and his colleague Damien Evans find another barrier and yet another structure.
There's also this structure, which is right next to it. And this is obviously a staircase, and then there's a staircase on the other side.
Right.
So you get this odd business that it's like something to get across the structure.
And what about the paving stones underneath? I mean, is there an elevated sort of walkway in the base of the channel?
No, we're
as
actually
well?
Standing on it.
Right.
So yeah. This is...
So this isn't just mounted earth?
No, this is a slabbed structure that runs all the way across, and its edge is just behind you. Mm.
This barrier must have acted like a threshold, slowing the water, but not halting it.
What they've got to do with the vast quantities of water they have here is they've got to bring that water to a halt. They've got to slow it down all the time. They've got to get the sediment out of it, and then they've got to move it to where they want to move it.
The canals of Angkor have received scant attention over the years, probably because the recovery and restoration of the temple itself was the primary focus. But Damien Evans and Roland Fletcher of the Greater Angkor Project are out to change that. They want to find out if the water system fostered the rise and expansion of Khmer civilization. Evans investigates a tunnel underneath the walls of Angkor Thom. It means magnificent city, another major temple.
This device is designed to bring water from that moat inside the city, this walled city of Angkor Thom, into a reservoir just over here. So obviously very practical purpose. This reservoir would have been used by the people who lived in this area for their everyday uses of household activities and that kind of thing. So again, this sort of dual aspect of ritual and functional, which is displayed at sites like this.
Damien and his colleague Sam are looking for evidence that other distant settlements may have been linked to Angkor by water. About 6 miles northwest of Angkor Wat, they find an area without obvious elaborate waterworks. And yet, even here, they discover a concealed temple. Like other temples, this ruin sits on slightly higher ground. It too used to be the center of a settlement with houses, a market, and farmers' fields. The architecture matches many of the temples of Angkor, which suggests that they may have been connected. And that can only mean by canals.
It's looking nice on the walls.
Whereas previously Angkor was well known as a tightly defined central district, a walled city in the middle of this huge plain, increasingly what we're finding is that there was a great deal of life beyond those city walls, and that there was this very large web of settlement which stretched beyond that nicely planned center of the city.
No ancient inscriptions tell us the number of people living in Angkor, but the stone carvers recorded a great many details of everyday life. They brilliantly captured not only the goings-on of their kings and their gods, but also the life of ordinary mortals, whose focus was and is the market. Marketplaces opened quite early every day and were trading places and news centers. Women were apparently the better stallholders, according to the ancient sculptors. Rice and corn were currency for small trades, while prestige goods, pots and animal skins, were paid for with gold and silver. Specialized traders offered the skulls of deer and other animals, possibly for use in rituals. Vegetables, fruit, fish, and poultry were always available, and women were dazzled by fine silver jewelry. According to the diary of a Chinese visitor just before 1300 AD, buyers were spoiled for choice. Ivory, rhinoceros horn, beeswax, gum resin, and cardamom were available, as well as wines made from honey, rice, or sugar. And it all depended on the watery transportation network to flourish. Not just near the main temples, but also in the outlying areas that are completely deserted today.
Looted down there as well. Yeah,
right. But just how far did Angkor reach? And is enough of the transport network left after centuries of decay? And if its prosperity depended on its canals, what could have made it decline and fall? To find out how far the Angkor civilization stretched, Damien Evans expands his research beyond the temple walls of Angkor Thom. They begin their search for buried temples and waterways at a measured pace. not because of snakes or scorpions, but because of Cambodia's darker recent past. The reign of terror of the Khmer Rouge from 1975 to 1979 did not spare Angkor. The temples were largely unharmed. Not even the brutal dictator Pol Pot dared trifle with the proudest symbols of Cambodia's heritage. But his troops mined a great deal of the area to keep their enemies at bay. Only in the 1990s could special units begin detecting and detonating landmines. In Angkor, archaeology can kill. So far, Roland Fletcher's team has worked all over Angkor without incident. But that's because they make aerial surveys before they set out.
Prop clear.
Clear prop.
In 2002, Damien Evans began using an ultralight aircraft equipped with a camera to search for archaeological sites on terrain that may be mined. That was fine for avoiding mines, but finding the hidden boundaries of Angkor required something more. The temple sites they were looking
that those images draw out.
The team found the perfect tool for the job at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in California. It turns out space is extremely useful to earthbound archaeology. On one of the flights of the space shuttle, NASA directed the attention of the crew to Cambodia to map the whole Angkor region. What the space shuttle delivered were images of Angkor, color-coded, and showing countless man-made changes in the terrain, seen here in green and yellow. What was needed now was a closer look at elevation, slight rises in the height of the soil. These could indicate earthen platforms for as yet undiscovered temple sites. And so a second NASA mission took off for Angkor, on a plane, not a spaceship. The plane carried AIRSAR, an all-weather imaging radar, which could shoot through cloud cover. What's more, it could also penetrate the forest canopy.
We knew from talking to the archaeologists that a lot of the sites of archaeological interest had subtle elevation differences from a fraction of a meter to several meters, and varied in size from maybe 20 meters on a side to over a kilometer on a side. And what we were able to do with the data is by color coding the elevation differences, we were able to make subtle height differences very visible and easy to find.
The images showed conspicuous height differences that could well turn out to be archaeological features. Of the hundreds of potential sites, only a few were expected to yield new structures that might have been part of a larger Angkor. But then, Damien combined all these results into a new map. A map that gave the world a new Angkor altogether. All of it linked by waterways. This was suddenly a vast city, littered with structures. more than 70 unknown buildings and hundreds of archaeological sites. In an area of more than 1,000 square kilometers, three times greater than ever imagined. Archaeological signposts were suddenly identified in places that had been considered before, but without result. Newfound temple sites were in some cases just subtle humps and bumps in the landscape, lurking in the jungle for centuries, just waiting for an inquiring mind to come along. The future for archaeology in Angkor is suddenly very promising.
What we've discovered with these new maps is the urban landscape of Angkor beyond the well-known temples in the middle. We've systematically documented hundreds of new sites, including temples and canals, which really give a picture of the urban landscape of Angkor as a whole. You really need the aerial perspective to bring that into sharper focus. In its entirety, it stretches across at least 1,000 square kilometres, which makes it really in the same league as the modern-day metropolises that many of us live in.
This finding has changed history. Angkor is not just magnificent architecture. This was a culture that supported a large, seemingly content population and seems to have done it with style and grace. And water. No water-dependent civilization has ever had so much success for so long. So the ancient Khmer may have a message in a bottle that could prove useful to us. And just possibly life-saving. Angkor was not just its temples, it was the cultural and economic center of the region. And that's why it's so instructive for modern city planners. This was a metropolis bigger than New York City. New York has an area of 780 square kilometers. Discovery of the new sites puts Greater Angkor at more than 1,000 square kilometers, the largest city of the pre-industrial world. The ingenious water management system made it all work. The system connects the far-flung settlements with each other. Roland Fletcher has moved his team to the end of the structure, the ancient canal near the East Barai, which they have worked on so intensively over the last few days. These modern engineers are stunned by the sophistication of the Khmer waterworks. Roland has discovered a small channel along the edge of the wall. But it comes as a surprise to find the end of the structure so abruptly blocked. Normally, at a place like this, it would be essential to keep the water flowing.
What is most interesting about this is that it stops at this point. And this here has a lot of laterite gravel in it. So there is a possibility that the structure from here on has actually been removed.
But why clip the end off a canal? Wasn't this a vital part of their system, connected directly to the reservoir? It's not enough for scientists to record what they find. They need to understand it. When archaeologists identify alterations in a structure, they call it a structure with a history. And like all history, it needs to be read. Damien and Sam are taking core samples to find out just how important the canal really was. If it has a stone floor, this may be a major canal.
Yeah, I mean, it's a very, very sharp boundary. So, I mean, this is what you'd expect in a canal. Like you've got
sandy
sands in there. I mean, it's still very clay. And look, you've actually got quite a coarse grain in there. And this is obviously a laterite rock block that we've just caught into.
The really interesting thing about this particular place is that it seems to have a masonry floor, a constructed stone base to it. And that's not something that you see very often at all in the Angkorian world. There are only maybe two or three instances of this that I know of.
Most of the paved canals are used for the water supply in the center of the city. But the Khmer built another outside their city. This one seems to have had a spiritual purpose. These stones are the tops of Linga, symbols of the Hindu god Shiva. They represent the power of creation and the promise of fertility. Water, and especially flowing water, is often endowed with spiritual properties that lift it out of the ordinary. The carved bed of Kabal Spin is perhaps the holiest of all the canals in Angkor. Underwater, the lingas here represent Shiva in his absolute form. Each of them confronts, delays, or propels the water. Water which is seen as fertilizing the land of the Khmer, just as the river Ganges does in India. Lowland flats, merging with the moats and barrages in the center of Angkor. The now sanctified canal connects the holy waters of Kabal Spin with the city. For too long, many archaeologists assumed these hydraulic structures, like the settlements, were only found near the central temples. But they were wrong. We know now that the water system was much greater than anyone guessed.
Before the aerial approach was systematically applied at Angkor, people knew of maybe two dozen canals in this area. We now know of over 200, close to 250 probably. So a lot of the old arguments about the water management system, that it wasn't very complex, that it wasn't very elaborate, that it had no distribution system, we now know to be false. So really it's turned some of the traditional arguments about Angkor and the system and the role it played at Angkor completely upside down. In fact, we know now that the water management system was capable of providing additional food by way of irrigation to a substantial number of people, and that it really would have made a significant difference to the viability of Angkor as a settlement.
It was all a vast, spidery network of waterways and basins. Life-giving canals, supplying the people and pleasing the gods. A thousand years ago, the aim of the Khmer rulers was probably to guarantee a continuous water flow for the paddy fields to maximize the yields. A burgeoning population had to be fed. Rice farmers have been in central Cambodia since about 3000 BC, but Angkor vastly increased demand. More and more new channels and ponds were dug. The need for consistent rice harvests meant Angkor's water system was the wellspring of power for its rulers. The Khmer must have worked constantly with brigades of diggers and engineers to upgrade and maintain their canals. The work was organized under a strong central authority, aware of the hazards of failure. Drought, famine, disease, and economic collapse if the transport system should break down. Today, the descendants of the ancient Khmer are again at work on a canal. At the East Barai, they reveal an unexpected feature, which seems to undercut the theory that the structure is an outlet for the reservoir.
It's all that way. No, no, not up there, here.
The excavation has exposed another wall, but this one is a lateral wall running across the entire canal.
What this tells us is that the channel, which was originally open running through to the east, was at some point blocked by putting this enormous wall right across the channel.
This wall is massive, more than a meter high and 3 meters wide. This is not built to slow the water, but to stop it completely. Judging by the masonry, Roland Fletcher dates it to the 12th or 13th century, hundreds of years after the canal was first built. But why would the Khmer block a canal they had worked on so intensely? Why would they stop water flowing out of the Barai? The answer is, the water wasn't flowing out of the Barai. It was now coming into the Barai. And that could indicate a possible water shortage.
At some point after the 12th century, the use of this structure has been turned around. It's been turned from being an outlet to being an inlet.
To bring in new water, the Khmer opened a wide gap in its longitudinal walls. To move fresh water into this structure, they diverted a 20-meter-wide neighboring canal, flowing in the opposite direction. That means water would have been gushing into the Barai.
The context then is that they are stopping the original use of the Barai as a mechanism for shunting water elsewhere in Angkor. So then the question comes, what is involved in stopping moving that water? If they're holding this water here, what then are they using it for? And what is happening to the areas that no longer get water?
As more and more temples were built at Angkor in the 12th century, it's likely that the demand for water was rising too. In fact, King Jayavarman VII embarked on a grand construction program of both public works and monuments. In his 40-year reign, the king began work on numerous temples. It's said that 80,000 people worked to build and maintain the temple of Ta Prohm. And Ta Prohm is not even half the size of Angkor Wat. It took a lot of stone breaking, transport and carving to make a temple. And armies of humans to do the back-breaking work. Many of them would have been slaves. The best way to understand Khmer building techniques is to do it ourselves. Here, the old collapsed stones are being reassembled. The reconstruction of Bafwan Temple has been underway for 50 years, and the results are often confused and frustrating. But a German-Cambodian team has found a way to re-erect a temple in a fraction of the time, virtually. Their training ground is the Prayer Khan Temple, built in the late 12th century. The project is called Virtual Angkor. It's based at the University of Heidelberg, but not in its archaeology department. These are mathematicians, and their approach is very different.
The special way in which the Khmer, the ancient Khmer, constructed their temple is so that each stone is absolutely unique. It had a unique way in which it was fitted to the neighboring stones. You can even identify which stones were laid before each other. Each stone is very individual and very unique, and that simplifies the work, the mathematical and computational methods, in order to reconstruct the whole building from these elements.
So far, the project has reconstructed parts of the temple with software called the Angkor Temple Generator. It excludes all the combinations of neighboring stones that can't work, and then uses the remaining options to assemble a structure that must be correct. It's an expensive but satisfying jigsaw puzzle, a puzzle that will bring this ancient world back to life. Why do so many stones have these characteristic holes? Something you don't see on Egyptian pyramids or Mayan temples. A relief from the Bayon temple wall reveals the secret. Khmer engineers invented a way of lifting the blocks without needing a rope underneath. This ensured the blocks had a very tight fit. It was grueling work. The largest stones weighed over 2 tons. The enormous pressures on the seams made the gaps almost invisible and allowed the sculptors to carve right across them. This sanding technique grinds the stones smoother and smoother. In time, the faces become so completely flat that not even a palm leaf can slip between them. The holes in the sides of each block were for wooden poles, used as handles for grinding and for lifting the blocks. The holes encourage a belief that still has currency among Cambodians. The temples are the work of giants. The holes are simply where they put their fingers to lift the blocks. This belief has a kind of spiritual truth. This is architecture that's so stunning, it's fitting that it was built, if not for the gods, then by them. But something went seriously wrong, and archaeologists are getting closer to the reason why. Over time, the Khmer royal fascination with temples never diminished. In fact, the temples got larger and larger. Over 1,000 temples have now been identified in the Angkor region. More and greater temples demanded more workers. More workers needed more rice, and more rice paddies had to be watered with more canals. It couldn't last.
What you're looking at in this area, and that this huge system managed, this 1,000 square kilometers of channels, would be somewhere up to about 750,000 human beings. And it's perfectly feasible for this landscape to actually provide rice for that number of people. The big question, and this is the thing that shows up in a structure like this, is whether in fact the infrastructure eventually became a problem in itself.
This area, barely inhabited today, looked completely different in ancient times. Near the main temples, there was a sea of simple wooden houses. At a time when London had about 30,000 inhabitants, almost 1 million people lived in Angkor. People also lived in the suburbs stretched out along the canals, an urban strip development, as in so many American suburbs today. Angkor flourished for six centuries. But around 1400 AD, the dream began to die. The urban complex had outreached its resources. The people who had built the imposing Barais canals and temples failed to keep pace with change and growth. The growing problems are clearly visible. This wall was once a bridge east of the city center during the heyday of Angkor. What was a walkway across the canal was turned into a dam by blocking its spans and diverting the water to more needy places. But soon the dam failed.
Unlike earlier bridges in the Angkor period, which were very carefully crafted from custom-made blocks, here they've basically pillaged blocks from a nearby temple to build it. So. We start to get the feeling at this stage of Angkor's history that more and more ad hoc. The Angkorian people essentially remodeled and reconfigured the entire landscape in this area. All of the forest was cleared completely, and the entire landscape was rebuilt into a human environment rather than the pre-existing natural environment.
Ever since European traders in the late 16th century first described the impressive towers of Angkor Wat, people have wondered why this once gilded temple was abandoned 500 years ago. The usual suspects include marauding invaders, a religious revolution, or a geological upset. But the collapse here suggests something different. That environmental mishaps can doom even the most carefully engineered urban landscapes. The Khmer were the oldest civilization in Southeast Asia. According to mythology, they were descended from the serpent god Naga. After 600 years of growth, their city witnessed its tragic downfall. The kings lost their influence, and the hemorrhaging could not be stopped. In the 15th century, Phonir Yat, the last king of Angkor, made a final desperate attempt to change the gods' minds and save the empire. In a ritual which had been performed for centuries, Naga, the snake goddess, who ruled over Angkor's prosperity, appeared every night in the shape of a beautiful girl to unite with the king. The Khmer rulers were the links between heaven and earth, mediators between the gods and mankind. Usually, it was believed the encounter brought wealth and growth. But on this night, the stakes were higher. The act had to save the empire from catastrophe. But Naga, for the very first time, scorned the king. And the Khmer reluctantly began to leave their city. Their gods were gone, and the city was given back to nature. Since that time, the trees have forced their roots into every crevice and have scattered vast stones like feathers. A people had overexploited their resources and paid the consequences. It's a familiar story.
Well, the resonance of this is rather eerie. If you think of what we're looking at, we have a giant infrastructure, and that's part of an enormous network that covers 1,000 square kilometers. What's really eerie about this, we have giant infrastructure in a massive low-density city. And that is exactly what we have in the modern world. The industrial world produces low-density cities with massive infrastructure. When you add on top of that, that somewhere between the 1300s and the 1700s, there was a climate change globally, whose impact we don't understand yet here, it all begins to look rather topical.
In the end, most of the people of Angkor left their city. But some temples were never completely abandoned. A handful of temple servants and monks tirelessly struggled to save a few from absolute ruin. And in contrast to Greek or Egyptian ruins, Angkor has remained a pilgrimage site for Buddhists. Angkor's spiritual heritage is intact. That is the final and paradoxical message of these stones. The spirit lives on.